last week I saw a snapshot of a tombstone of a little lady, and I'm sure she was a grandmother, you know, and she'd lived a full life. You could tell by the dates, and it had her name, and it had the dates of her life. And you know, I don't know, some of you may be curious like me, but I read tombstones if I ever go to a cemetery, and it's neat to kind of see what different people say about people, and it's a reflection back on them. And all it said on it, though, was a love that gave. And so that just kind of struck me. I said, that's kind of odd. I mean, it sounds sweet, but what does that mean, a love that gave about a person? And so after a couple of days, God just downloaded into me, said, put the words, she was, in front of it. She was a love that gave. What a testimony of a life, that that's what your family thought about you. I truly hope and pray that that's how that I'm remembered after I pass, that I was a love that gave. And I asked God, I said, you know, with all the scriptures, when you look at the concordance, there's pages and pages and pages of the word love. And I said, God, there's got to be an example of that in scripture. And Sherry and I were doing a Bible study, and the very first scripture that was in our study was this, 1 Corinthians 13:4-8. Love is kind and patient, never jealous, boastful, proud, or rude. Love isn't selfish or quick-tempered. It doesn't keep a record of wrongs that others do. Love rejoices in the truth, but not in evil. Love is always supportive, loyal, hopeful, and trusting. Love never fails. If we ever, ever get to the point to where our love that we display here at Hosanna does not reflect this, then we become like every other dead church in America, every closed church in America, because it's easy to just come in and say, I love you, brother, and then walk out the door, and you don't display it, and it's not a part of your life. We need to do these things inside the church. Do we do these things? There's a Christian band named Jesus Culture, and they've got a song with the words that reflects that scripture, and here's just a part of it. I want you to listen to this, and Mel, I bet you know this one by heart. Higher than the mountains that I face, stronger than the power of the grave, constant in the trials and the change, one thing remains. Your love never fails, it never gives up, and it never runs out on me. Come on, say that with me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, and it never runs out on me. Isn't that awesome? That's awesome. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your love. Father, right now we come to worship you, Lord, and to be ministered to. But Lord, I just pray that you would give us your kind of love. Put it in our heart that we don't keep the wrongs that others do to us. When we look at others with a haughty eye, if they've said something that we weren't crazy about, or we thought that they looked at us crooked when really, we don't know what was going on in their minds that morning. We really don't. They might have just gotten bad news about a loved one or something, and it has nothing to do with us. And you know, I saw a t-shirt, Lord, it just says, it's not about me. It's all about you and your kingdom. Father, I just want to thank you for this church that it has displayed that and displayed it to me the first day I walked in these doors. They displayed to me a love that never fails, and they've never stopped loving me, and you've never stopped loving me. That's why it's so easy to proclaim the things that I do when I meet people about you, Lord. I can't ever talk about you enough, Lord. Lord, today I ask you that you touch someone, either through the scripture we just read or through the worship from our worship team, Lord, or from the message is being brought this morning. Lord, I just ask that you touch their lives, change their lives, change them from the inside out, Lord. We love you, and we're going to worship you right now from the bottom of our heart and try to just show back just a little bit of love, of the great love that you gave, that you so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son, Jesus. That's a love that never fails, and that's a love that gave. Thank you for that gift of love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Still blessed. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun is shining down on me, when the world is all as it should be. Blessed be your name. And still, Lord, blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain, offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory. The Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. You give and take away, Lord. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, blessed be your name. You give and take away. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name, Lord Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Come on and lift up the name of the Lord. God, you are so worthy, Lord. We choose to bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. I thank you, God, that you can never fail.
My God can never fail. He's been proved time and again. Touch him and see he's got all the power you need. He's never early. He's never early. He's never late. He takes courage and it takes faith. Touch him and see he's got all the power you need. Saves, forgives, and heals. Takes back what the devil steals. My debt's been paid in full. And every day he does miracles. My God can never fail. It's been proved time and again. Trust him and see he's got all the power you need. He's got all the power you need.
living for miracles.
He's real.
He's real. He's real. Faith a lot stronger than what you feel. He's real. He's real. He's real. I'm believing for miracles. My God can never fail. He's been proved time and again. Trust him and see he's got all the power you need.
He saves. He saves, forgives, and heals.
Takes back what the devil steals. My debt's been paid in full. Every day does miracles.
My God can never fail. He's been proved time and again. Trust him and see he's got
all the power you need.
He's got
all the power you need.
Say, he's got all the power you need. Come on, lift up the name of the Lord. Jesus, I thank you that you are good. You are faithful. Lord, you are worthy in this place. Hallelujah. Lord God, we just take time to honor you and to lift up the name of Jesus. You are the reason we're here, Lord. We love you, Jesus. Lord, I thank you, Father. The song says, time and time again, I live day to day. But have I stopped to thank you for your love, Lord? Lord, we just thank you. We just take a minute to say thank you, Lord. Jesus.
Time and time again, I live from day to day. Have I stopped to thank you for your love? You've shown me grace, you've shown me your ways. So Lord, all I want is more of you. Lord, let your love surround. I want your love to surround me, yeah. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Set my eyes on you, Lord, 'cause all I want is more of you. I want your love to surround me, yeah. To feel the warmth of your embrace, Jesus. I want your love. To feel the warmth of your embrace.
Hallelujah. Father, I see that you are drawing a line in the sand. I want to be standing by your side, holding your hand. So let your kingdom come. Let it live in me. This is my prayer. This is my plea. Let the worshipers. Let the sons and the daughters sing to you, Jesus. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters. And the daughters sing to you, Jesus. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. So then, let the worshipers arise. Yeah. Let the sons and the daughters. Every nation are awakening to sing from our hearts that comes an anthem. Hear the heavens ring. This is a song, a song for our King. Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing to you. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. So let it rise. Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing to you, Jesus. I'm surrendering. Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing to you, Lord. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King of Kings. So let the worshipers. Surrendering my all, I surrender to the King. It's the song of the redeemed as the saints from every nation are awakening to sing. From our hearts there comes an anthem. Oh, hear the heavens ring. This is a song, a song for our King. Let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. So let the worshipers arise. Let the sons and the daughters sing to you alone. I'm surrendering. Control of everything, of all creatures great and small. Say he counts the stars. He counts the stars one and all. He knows how much sand is on the shore. He sees every sparrow that falls. Jesus, he made the mountains and the sea. He's in control. But he took that loss. every step that I take, every move that I make, every tear that I cry. He knows my name when I'm overwhelmed by the pain. I can't see the light of day, but I know I'll be just fine. 'Cause he knows my name. Yes, he does. Say he knew. He knew who I was when he carried the cross. Jesus, you were so good. He knew I would fail him, but he took the loss. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He knew who I was when he carried the cross. He knew I would fail him, but he took the loss. That's love, Lord, that's love. He knew who I was when he carried the cross. That's a love that gives. He knew I would fail him, but he took the love. And he knows my name. Every step that I take, every move that I make, every tear that I cry, he knows. I surrender to the King. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. Father, we just bring a sacrifice of praise in this place, Lord, for who you are, God, because you are good. You are God all by yourself, Lord. Lord, we just lift up the name of Jesus in this place, thanking you for who you are. Lord, I thank you that we can lay down our burdens, Lord, that we can lay down every weight, everything that would hold us back from pursuing the love of the Almighty. Lord, we love you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that we can surrender our all and we can love you with everything we have, God. Lord, I thank you that the worshipers are arising, Lord, to lift up and proclaim the name of Jesus in this place, in this land, Lord God. I thank you that you reign on this land, Lord God. I thank you, Lord, for good seed and good soil, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for a harvest, Lord. I thank you that you send us out. Lord, I thank you that we'll be the harvesters, Lord, that we'll go out and we'll be the workers in the harvest, Lord. I pray, God, that we'd be faithful to your call, Lord, whatever you call us to, God, that we'd be faithful and obedient. Lord Jesus, we surrender our all to you. Thank you for who you are. Lord, we lift you up, Jesus. I'm surrendering. I surrender to the King. Lord, we just let go of everything that would hold us back. I'm surrendering my all. I surrender to the King. Father, I'm so thankful for who you are. Lord, if you can use anybody, you can use me, you can use us, Lord. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Isn't God good to us? He is so good to us. Lord, we just thank you, Father, for who you are.
Serenity, or where is serenity? Serenity has something she wants to say.
Hey guys, it's just a reminder that High Top's auditions are upstairs in the arcade right after church. We're just going to give glory and honor to God using our gifts and talents, and the performance is going to be next Saturday, so I'm really excited. So if you're ages 13 to 20 or a little older or a little younger, meet me upstairs. We're going to have a lot of fun. Thank you.
Glory. How many of you are going through a tough time right now? Let me see. Well, I just want to say something to you this morning. And I thought about this earlier when we were worshiping, praising the Lord. And I just felt in my spirit to say this to you. I believe God wants you to know that you've been, it's just like in my life, I've been through enough to know that He is more than enough to see me through the changes that are coming in my life. How many of you are going through some changes? I want to say it one more time. I have been through enough to know that He is more than enough. He is more than enough to see me, see you through the changes that are coming in your life. Amen? Amen. God bless you. At this time, we're going to ask Marvin Horton to come up. Let's give him a big applause.
How's everybody doing this morning? Amen, amen. We ready to get into the word this morning? Well, first let me ask this, because how many of you believe in divine intervention? In other words, the hands of God playing in things. Okay. Now, I usually don't make my messages until a day or two before. Reason being, and I know people that do it a week ahead of time, nothing wrong with that. But too many times I've done that, and then right at the last end, the Holy Spirit has said, change it. So I've gotten to the point and said, well, if I'm going to keep changing it, I'm just going to wait. Well, what Brother Rayford was just saying, telling you that if you're going through something, to hold on. Well, my message is pertaining to that day, and I promise you, Brother Rayford and I did not collaborate on that. We haven't talked since the earlier part of the week, and we didn't discuss the message then. So I believe there's something that God is trying to tell someone in here today. And hopefully I can, you know, make that message even more clear to you. Because I always say if I reach one person, then I've done what God wants me to do. Now, for those of you that haven't heard me preach, I was blessed to be up here once before, but some of you haven't heard me preach. You're not familiar with my style. I don't filibuster a lot. I mean, I talk more now than I normally do, but I just kind of want you to get used to me. And I have a brother that's a minister. He can go on all day long. You know, he took after my dad. I took after my mom. I said what I got to say. I used to say we were like two boxers. You know, he's like Ali or Sugar Ray. He dances around on here. I'm more like Mike Tyson. I just walk in there and punch you and go home. But something even better the other day came across my mind. I hadn't thought about it in a while. Anybody remember a movie called The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly? Okay, you may not remember this scene, but for some reason it crossed my mind when Tuco, the Mexican guy, he was in the tub taking a bath. This guy busts in on him, and he's talking about, you know, he's going to kill him, how glad he found him, sitting like he is. He's been looking for him 8 months. While he's talking, Tuco just pulls a gun out of the water and shoots him. He gets up, finishes him off, and remember what he said? If you're going to shoot, shoot, don't talk. With that being said, I'm getting ready to shoot. Before our scripture, we're coming out of the 16th chapter of John. We're going to bounce around a little bit. I usually frown on bouncing around, but there's nothing wrong with it as long as you don't take it out of context. Now, you know, you got some people that are bouncing around and try to get it twisted around to get you to see their point of view, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to hit the high points, but it's going to be the 16th chapter of John, and we're going to start with the first verse. And I'm going to be reading out of the New International Version. All this I have told you so that you will not fall away. They will put you out of the synagogue. In fact, the time is coming when anyone who kills you will think they are offering a service to God. They would do such things because they have not known the Father or me. I have told you this so that when their time comes, you will remember that I warned you about them. I did not tell you this from the beginning because I was with you. But now I am going with him who sent me. None of you ask me, where are you going? Rather, you are filled with grief because I have said these things. Okay, now we're going to skip down to the 20th verse. Read the 20th through the 22nd. Very truly I tell you, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come. But when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that a child is born into the world. So with you, now is your time of grief. But I will see you again, and you will rejoice, and no one will take away your joy. And last of all, the 33rd verse. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And I chose these particular passages because Jesus is telling his disciples, you know, you're going to see hard times. Things are going to get bad, and they're continually going to get worse. And it looks like that today. Things are steadily going downhill. But also, I dare say that the best is yet to come as well. That's why Jesus tells us to be of good cheer. Now, it's easy to be pessimistic about the way things are going today. I give you that. Now, the economy's down. A lot of our social services we've been getting are being cut out. Major corporations falling apart. Technology. I mean, what's new today, tomorrow is old hat, and a lot of us can't keep up with it. It seems like we're either in a war or somebody's always trying to pick a fight with us. And the saddest thing to me, a country that was founded on biblical principles and founded on God, that country is now trying to write God out of the equation. Yep. Things have gotten bad. And they steadily going from bad to worse. I mean, but now going back to the text, if anybody had reason during that time to be disappointed, I'd imagine it would be the disciples, because up to now they hadn't been tested, and they were on their way to becoming hated, pursued, falsely persecuted, condemned, tortured, killed. Up to now, all they did was follow Jesus around and do what he told them to do, and, you know, kind of living the easy life that he's telling them. Now the time's come to pay the piper. You're going to have to prove your worth. And at this point in the text, they really hadn't seen bad time compared to what was going to lie ahead. And that we as believers in Christ, that happens to us, but we can experience something in the middle of our pain and sorrow that the world can't even begin to experience. See, we're special. We're special because the world can't claim this, but believers can. We can experience joy in the middle of any crisis. Now, I know this will raise some questions because, you know, someone may ask, well, how can somebody who's terminally ill lay in a hospital and say everything's going to be all right? How can somebody who's going through a divorce say I still have joy? Well, I've been through a divorce, and I can tell you it depends on the divorce, but still, you can still have joy. Now, I'm not the only one with troubles, but in the last few weeks, I've had two uncles that I lost to sickness. One of them I said goodbye to 2 days ago, and two brothers. And it was tough on me because I pretty much grew up with them, so they were more like big brothers to me than uncles. And I was close with both of them. But think about it. Now, how can somebody who's just lost a loved one or a best friend, for that matter, how can they still say that they have joy? How can somebody who's having financial problems at home, getting attacked every way you can think of, how can they still stand up and say, I have joy, and I'm still going to praise God? It's simply because God has enabled us to experience separation in suffering. You can be in the middle of pain, but you can still have joy in the middle of your pain. You can be physically hurting, but you can still have joy in your soul. You can be mentally exhausted, but still have peace of mind. And this is one of the things that Jesus is trying to get across to his disciples while he's filling them in on what's about to come. He knows that it's going to be a few short days and he'll be crucified. And he knows in a few days that they're going to put his body in a grave. But he also knows 3 days later, he's going to rise and he's going to remain on the earth for 40 more days. And then he'll be returned to his rightful place in glory. These disciples have been called out from the world to become the followers of Jesus. They're strangers in the world now because Jesus says his disciples are not of this world and his kingdom is not of this world. And these disciples have left their all to follow Jesus. Now, the book of John gives us a clear picture of Jesus' life. Now, chapters 1 through 12 show his public ministry. 13 through 17 shows us his private ministry with his disciples before the cross. 18 and 19 present the cross to us. 20 and 21 show us the resurrection and afterwards. And in chapter 16, where I'm coming from today, Christ is getting his disciples ready for the cross. He knows that when he leaves from earth, they'll be surrounded by this screwed up world system. They'll still be left in the world, so to speak. So in a sense, this is kind of a farewell counseling session. The world that Jesus refers to in his discussion is not the world in the physical sense. He's not talking about the rocks and the trees, the water, the sky, the seasons, and the sun. No, he's talking about a mean, cruel world that's controlled spiritually by the devil. Now, remember, Jesus tells us that we are in the world, but not of the world. Now, I don't doubt some of us know the world pretty well. And not from what somebody told us either, but from experience. Tell you a little about myself. I was raised up in Coffeyville, you know, up until the time I was 17, the furthest I've been in my life was Memphis, Tennessee, and a couple of trips to Jackson. Other than that, hadn't been anywhere. My parents, when my daddy got saved, he went wide open. It wasn't nothing to visit four churches on a Sunday. Seriously. And I'm talking in a couple of different counties, too. I don't want to say I had a strict childhood, but some of you preachers' kids probably had more freedom than I had. So anyway, I joined the Army while I was still in high school. I graduated high school. Like I said, never been any further than Memphis or Jackson. Got on a plane, headed to Fort Sill, Oklahoma. Home of the field artillery. Yeah. Did my basic at Fort Sill. Of course, in basic training, you're restricted. Can't go anywhere. Well, I left there and went to Fort Jackson, South Carolina for my advanced individual training, which is supposed to be a little more relaxed. But if you were in Fort Jackson in the 80s, you know. Even the people that were stationed there said it was worse than basic training. Left there, went to Fort Benning, Georgia. Had a little more freedom, but I was still in training. Finally, I got to my duty station, Fort Stewart, Georgia. No training. This is my job. This is what I'm going to do. I was free to do whatever I wanted. By then, I was the ripe old age of 19. And I did what any child that was brought up in a strict upbringing would do that had the church constantly drilled into them. And they got their taste of freedom. I went buck wild. But now I admit now some of my parents' teaching did stay with me. There were some things that thank God I did stick to and it kept me out of trouble. But I did test the water every now and then. But that was how I got my experience with the world. And I mean that doesn't happen to everybody. Some people get turned loose in the world and they don't come back. Some people get out there and it never affects them. It depends on the individual. But see, once you get turned out in the world, that's what can happen to you. And the world can take a strong man and it can turn him into an addict, be it a crackhead, a porno addict, an alcoholic, or whatever. The world will take a tight-knit family and make them go their separate ways, constantly at each other's throat. The world can make a young girl look old. It can make an old woman try to look young. The world system, and I don't mean that in a bad sense, but you know, some of it goes to the point of being ridiculous. That's what I'm talking about. The world will make fun of spirituality and lift up wickedness and foolishness. I mean, we can see that today. Thank you. We saw that yesterday. Fortunately for the believer, though, the world is not our home, as Jesus said. The words that Jesus shared with us are meant to prepare us for the worst and yet anticipate the best. Now, thank God that although he directly spoke to the disciples in the text, that he's still sharing his word with us. Now, just like he was speaking to the disciples, he's speaking to us today. And we do know that there's power in the words of Jesus. He can say, peace be still, and the winds and the waves will stop. He can speak and closed ears will open and the mute can speak. He can say, come forth and a dead man will rise. There's someone out here right now that knows that you would have given up a long time ago, but you had a word, just a word from Jesus, a word sent by someone to keep you going. You were going to quit, but greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You were going to sit around and feel sorry for yourself, but weeping endures for a night, but joy comes in the morning. You thought you were going to lose your mind, but he's able to keep you in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on him. You were going to give up all hope, but the Lord is your light and your salvation. He says, I've spoken unto you these things, these matters, these prophecies, that in me you might have peace. See, the key to peace is found in Jesus. You can't get peace any other way or by any other method than by Jesus. And the Greek word that John uses in this text to suggest peace is that there is peace, there is rest, there's quietness. There's a way that leads to salvation. There is no failure. But now you know that if Christ is the source of encouragement and peace in our lives, then the devil is what? The source of discouragement. Now the devil works overtime to discourage us in his life. And he'll throw everything he can at us to cause us to lose sleep, lose patience, lose hope, lose joy, lose our sanity. But you have to know that through Christ, you have peace. Now Romans 5:5-1 says, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Proverbs 16:7 says, when the Lord take pleasure in everyone's ways, he causes their enemies to make peace with them. So, see, even when my ways please the Lord, I can still have peace with my enemies. And the world is out of control, but I have peace. The crime rates up, but I have peace. Now, some of you on Facebook, you may have seen what Brother Damon put on there the other day, and when I saw it, I chuckled, but I agreed with him. He said the world was headed downhill like a snowball to hell. And he's right, it is, the way things are going. I agree with him wholeheartedly. And, you know, but as long as we have Jesus, we still can have peace. As believers, we can go to hell and back, we can go through hell, but we still have peace. Now, the book of Acts tells us that Paul was shipwrecked, beaten, ridiculed, tried, tested, and he still demonstrated a life of peace. All right, let's bring it a little closer to home. Somebody's husband walks away and leaves them with a house full of kids and the rent due, but they still got peace. And I knew someone like that. Latest husband left her with 5 children. And she's going on the Lord. Now, during her time here on this earth, every time you saw her, she had a smile on her face because she had the love of Jesus in her heart. And I know that for a fact because I knew her personally. No matter how bad things got, that smile never left her face. You could have someone go to the doctor feeling fine and the doctor tell them that they're terminal and they can still have peace. I witnessed that. Had a cousin found out he had terminal cancer. He told him, well, I lived a good life. I'm ready to go. He refused treatment. That was that peace of God. And we can have that peace because we're in him. We're not just around him or near him. We're not just on a perimeter, on the premises, on the property, in 100 yards of him. We are in him. And the good news is that not only are we in him, but he's in us as well. And we should know that we're not the only ones that are in him. Now, I'm not the only one in here that found out that without Jesus, there's no peace. But to know Jesus, there is peace. The peace of knowing Jesus will change you from being overcome to being an overcomer. Now, Jesus said that in the world, in this cosmos, this world that we're in but not of, Jesus says that you're going to have tribulation. And he didn't say maybe, and he didn't say you might. It's definite. You're going to have tribulation. He said you might as well get ready for it, be prepared for it, anticipate it. It's in your destiny. You will have tribulation. And if you haven't had it yet, just keep on living. In Jesus, there's peace, but in the world and our surroundings, we have tribulation, we have afflictions, troubles, sorrows, and we will be persecuted if we stand up for God. Now, somebody here that's had pressure all week long, Brother Rayford mentioned earlier, and I raised my hand when he asked too because I've been in that boat. You got pressure in your family, pressure on your job, pressure in your checkbook. Oh, yeah. We live in a pressurized world, if you want to know the truth. Everything's pressurized. And as I said, if you think you hadn't had pressure yet, just keep on living. It's coming. But in the middle of your tribulation, Jesus doesn't say go ahead and give up. He doesn't say, well, you did your best and you tried. Go back home and cry about it. Jesus says, be a good cheer. He said, look, cheer up. You don't have to look sad. You don't have to cry all the time, drop your head all the time, feel sorry for yourself. He said, cheer up. And if you need a reason to cheer up, you ought to cheer up because he's pardoning your sin, if nothing else. If you need a reason to cheer up, you ought to cheer up because he has power. And if you need a reason to cheer up because he will never leave you or forsake you. Now, Jesus has already conquered situation. He's already prevailed in them. He's already got the victory over them. He overcame sickness, conquered trouble. He prevailed over hatred. He has the victory over poverty, but most of all, he handled death. He overcame death, although he died at Calvary. He conquered death because he got up with all power in his hand. He prevailed over death because he has the keys of death, hell, and the grave. He has the victory over the death because he is still alive. You see, God can transform our sorrows into joy. The wonder is not that we have trouble, but that he can give us peace in our trouble. No matter what you're going through, you can be of good cheer because he has the victory. We have the power because of the Holy Ghost, the power to endure, the courage to face problems, and the ability to celebrate the victory. And I don't know about you, but me, myself, I'm personally glad that I've got the victory, that I have the peace of God in me. Now, as I said, I'm brief. That's it. But I hope someone, seriously, I pray someone got something out of this message. I thank you for the time, and I thank Brother Damon for the opportunity once again. Now, turn it back over to Brother Rayford. Thank you, and God bless you.
Don't give up. Keep on keeping on. Because God is with us. He said he'll never leave us, never forsake us. I want to just read something to you right quick. This is out of Psalms 91. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, that's your choice. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my fortress, my God. In him will I trust. What are we trusting in? If you, hey, don't put your trust in the money, because it can go down tomorrow or today. Now listen to this. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come near thy dwelling. For he, God, for he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. He's a keeper. How many of you have got a keeper? God's our keeper. Now watch this, I'm going to read it one more time. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against the stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shall thou trample under feet. Why? Because, in other words, I could put this back in this too. He had been through enough that he knows God's going to get him through what he's going through. And he says, because he has set his love upon me, what have we got our love set upon? Don't put your trust in your money because it can go tomorrow. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I don't know about you, but I've been through some trouble. How many of you have been through some trouble? How many of you are going through some trouble? I see the hands. But I want to tell you something, that greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world, and he has made us more than the conquerors through Christ Jesus. He is for us, not against us. He's on our side. If God be for you, who can be against you? Now, I want to finish this now. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. Who's our deliverer? We're not self-deliverers. We got the deliverer that lives on the inside of us. He is our deliverer. And then the last verse in Psalm 91 says, with long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Show him my deliverance. Show him my healing. Show him
who we are in Christ Jesus. Would you stand to your feet?
If you're going through a tough situation in your life right now, I challenge you, by faith, step out and come up here and trust God to bring you through that situation. Go ahead and start the music. I challenge you to step out. There's a lot of people in this place. I sent in my spirit this morning that the Spirit, while they were worshiping and praying, in my spirit, I knew that there were a lot of people going through some difficulties in this life. But I want to tell you something. He's for you, not against you. He's on your side and He'll bring you through. Praise the Lord. Now, I want to ask this. How many of you have gone through some tough times and God has delivered you and set you free from it? Now, I want you to lift your hands toward these people that are going through some tough times. And let's believe God that He will minister and deliver and set free, praise God. Hallelujah. You know, my wife don't like for me to tell this, but I tell you what, I went to Bible college from 1974 to 1977 and ended up 30 days in a mental ward in a hospital in Pensacola, Florida, and they said, he's had it. He just messed up. He'll never be right. The doctor said, he's never be worth a plug nickel. Well, I want to tell you something. Glory to God. Hey. How many of you have gone through some mental situations in your life? I don't do like this. Yeah, you just a nobody, too, if you've gone through stuff like that. Hey, we've all gone through some tough times in our life, but I want to tell you, I've been through enough to know that He's more than enough to see us through the changes that are coming in our lives. Amen? All right, lift your hand toward them and we're going to pray for them right now. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we know that no weapon formed against us can succeed. We're going to have tribulations in this world. But You said, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. He has overcome it, and the overcomer lives in us. And Father, I thank You that You're going to bring them through this mental situation, financial situation, marital situation, whatever the situation is, You're more than enough. You're more than enough. And right now, in the name of Jesus, I thank You for deliverance, healing, health, financial difficulties be restored, and that they'll have more than enough to bless You. And Father, I thank You for the finances over this church, that the devil is not going to keep us down, but we're going to rise up and we're going to overcome in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.